Hello everyone, this is a series of two videos about bone tumors. In the first video, we're going to discuss the benign bone tumors. So let's get started. Bone tumors are classified into benign tumors and malignant tumors. The benign tumors only grow locally, so they do not metastasize to distant organs. Malignant tumors, in contrast, grow locally and distally, so they do metastasize to other organs. The malignant tumors can be either primary, which means they arise from the bone cells, or secondary, which means they are metastases from other organs, which metastasize to the bone. The first benign tumor is the non-ossifying fibroma. This is the most common benign tumor of all. Up to 40% of people under the age of 20 will have non-ossifying fibroma. This tumor is composed of fibrous tissue, so definitely it will contain fibroblasts because these are the ones that's going to make the fibrous tissue. They do also contain osteoclasts and histiocytes. These tumors are twice as common in males compared to females, so they are more common in males. They are most common in the metaphyses of the lower femur or the proximal tibia. This location, which is the lower femur and proximal tibia, is a very common location of a lot of tumors. We're going to see that when we discuss most of the tumors. And the reason why the metaphysis is a common site of bone tumors, as we discussed in the video of the bone structure, the metaphysis is an active or a very active site where there is new bone formation. So, and also this site is very or highly vascular. So it's a very common site for osteomyelitis and also a very common site of bone tumors. Most of these non-ossifying fibromas are asymptomatic, so they are just discovered by chance when doing x-ray for some reason. But still, in some cases, they can cause pain or even minor fracture. Mostly, they go away on their own, so they do not require any kind of treatment. This is an x-ray and CT scan that shows non-ossifying fibroma, and common among these tumors is this soap and bubble appearance, which is very similar to another tumor called giant cell tumor of bone. It's multilocular, that's why it gives us this soap and bubble appearance. The next tumor, which is also a very common tumor, is the osteochondroma. This is a cartilage-capped bony projection or outgrowth from the surface of the bone. And any bony outgrowth from the surface of the bone, it's always called exostosis. If this is a bony outgrowth from the surface of the bone, they call it exostosis. And there is a cartilage cap at the end of the tumor, and that's why it's composed of both cartilage component and bony component, and that's why it's called osteochondroma. This tumor is more common among young adolescent males, and most common affects the metaphysis of long bones, because again, the metaphysis is where you find a lot of chondrocytes, because these are the sites of new bone formation from the cartilage. So they stop growing also when there is a fusion of the growth plate. So they grow with the growth plate, and when the growth plate stops growing, they also stop growing. These tumors result from the mutation of two genes called exostosin 1 and exostosin 2. And these genes encode for something called heparin sulfate, which is glucose aminoglycan. Remember when we said the structure of the bony matrix contains glucose aminoglycans. Rarely, there is malignant transformation of this cartilaginous cap. It's just rare. It's not common to happen. These tumors usually treated with complete excision because we fear of this malignant transformation. This is the x-ray. You see long, slender, pedunculated stalk that looks like a cauliflower. And the cartilaginous cap is usually at the top of the tumor. If this cartilaginous cap is less than 2 centimeters, usually the risk of malignancy is much less. If it's thicker than this, then malignant transformation is very likely. Next is osteoma, which is a benign new bone growth on top of an existing bone. It most commonly affects the skull and the mandible, and also most commonly happens in something called Gardner's syndrome, which is an autosomal dominant disorder characterized by familial adenomatous polyposis, which is hundreds of polyps on the colon, and fibromas, which are tumors composed of fibrous tissue, usually in the retroperitoneum and epidermoid cysts on the skin. This is a CT scan of the skull that shows an osteoma emerging from the skull bone. Next is osteoid osteoma. This is a benign tumor of the osteoblasts. It's usually less than 1.5 centimeters in size. This is in comparison to its sister tumor, which is very similar to it, which is the osteoblastoma, which is greater than this size. It's most common in the diaphysis of long bones. This is the first time we mentioned the diaphysis. There is another malignant tumor called Ewing sarcoma. It's also very common in the diaphysis of long bones. This tumor is very common in young males, and it's characterized by intense nighttime pain that interferes with sleep. And this pain, very characteristically, is relieved with non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like aspirin. Histologically, it's composed of a nidus of osteoid and woven bone that's surrounded by a rim of reactive sclerotic bone. That's why it's called osteoid osteoma, because there is a nidus in the middle of osteoid and woven bone, and there is a rim of sclerotic bone surrounding it. This histological appearance is indistinguishable from the osteoblastoma, which is its sister tumor. But again, the size is what makes the difference. These tumors mostly disappear on their own. Again, this is a CT scan that shows this centrally located nidus of osteoid, and it's surrounded by the rim of sclerotic bone. Welcome to its sister, the osteoblastoma, which is again arises also from the osteoblasts. It's usually more than 2 centimeters in size compared to the osteoid osteoma and can be considered a giant osteoid osteoma. The pain here is less intense, less characteristic, and it's not worse at night, and it's not relieved by NSAIDs. And this is a very common high-yield point that's usually asked on exams. Again, it's histologically similar to the osteoid osteoma. Next is chondroma. This is a benign tumor arises from the chondrocytes or the cartilage-forming cells. Remember, it's called chondroma. There is no bony component of this tumor. So it's only composed of mature hyaline cartilage. It happens in bones formed from cartilage. Remember, there are two types of ossification of bone. There is the endochondral ossification and there is the intramembranous ossification. The endochondral ossification is where the bone is formed from cartilage. This is the kind of bone that usually gets affected with chondroma. For example, it typically affects the small bones of the hand and feet. It can cause swelling, pain, or pathological fracture, but can also be asymptomatic. If this tumor arises within the medullary canal, they call it enchondroma. If it's within the bony surface, it's called juxtacortical chondroma. This is an enchondroma of the lower part of the femur, and this is an enchondroma of the small bones of the hand, and you can see how it's making a swelling of these small bones. Giant cell tumor of bone is a very uncommon tumor that's characterized by the presence of multinucleated giant cells that resembles osteoclasts or the bone-eating cells. This tumor loves the epiphysis of long bones. And usually it's at the lower end of the femur or the upper end of the tibia. As we usually discussed, this location is very common for bone tumors. This location is around the knee, of course. This tumor is generally benign and very rarely can turn malignant. But the problem is it's locally aggressive and very destructive. It destroys the surrounding bone and adjacent joint. Remember, it's on the epiphysis, so it's very close to the joint surface. So it destroys the bone and the joint, and that's why it causes pain and restriction of joint motion, and this is a very common symptom. This tumor has to be treated with surgery, again, because it's very aggressive and destructive locally. Again, on histology, these are the osteoclast-like giant cells that eats up the bone and forms the giant cell tumor. And this is an X-ray that shows the giant cell tumor at the end of a long bone, and you can see this soap and bubble appearance again as we saw in the non-ossifying fibroma. Next, a simple bone cyst or unicameral or unilocated bone cyst. This is a benign cavity filled with yellow colored fluid. It's common in children and adolescents, so it's in the young age population. It's mostly asymptomatic and discovered incidentally on imaging. Common, it's growing near the growth plates again. They grow with the growth plate and they stop growing when the growth plate fuses. And this type of simple bone cysts is called active cysts, because there is another type called latent cysts. These grow away from the growth plate, so they are stable in size. The active cysts near the growth plate, they can grow in size and cause pathological fracture. Surgery is recommended only if there is a risk of fracture or if the risk of fracture is high. This is a unicameral bone cyst on the proximal end of the humerus, and you can see it's causing a pathological fracture. Unicameral or unilocated means it's only one compartment. It's not multilocated like other cysts or other tumors. In contrast to that, we have the aneurysmal bone cyst, which is benign also tumor that's composed of multiple varying sizes of spaces that's filled with blood, not yellow fluid like the other one. This one is highly destructive, explosive, and expansible. Whenever you hear the word aneurysmal, think of something bad. So aneurysmal bone cyst is a bad cyst. It can cause destruction, it can cause fractures. So pain, swelling, and pathological fractures are common in this type of bone cyst. It can also compress nearby structures like nerves. It can be idiopathic, but also it's commonly secondary to other bone lesions, like most commonly the giant cell tumor. Curettage surgery with bone grafting can be done for treatment because these bone cysts, again, are bad. Remember the aortic aneurysm, where the wall of the aorta becomes weak and expands, makes an aneurysm? This is the same idea here, and this is the idea why it's called aneurysmal bone cyst. They cause swelling, and they destruct or compress the nearby structures. As you can see here, we see a balloon-like expansion with periosteal new bone formation surrounding this bone cyst. And with MRI imaging, you see it's multilocated and it's filled with blood. Definitely, we cannot see the blood here, but we see that it's multilocated. Another benign condition that can affect the bone, which is not a tumor, is called fibrous dysplasia. Fibrous, from fibrous tissue, and dysplasia means the displacement of the existing or the normal tissue. So the normal tissue is displaced or transformed into a different tissue. So this is a replacement of the normal bone tissue with fibrous tissue, resulting in a weaker bone that's prone to fracture. It can affect one bone. In this case, we call it monoosteotic, or multiple bones. In this case, we call it polyosteotic. It can be an isolated disorder, but more commonly, it's part of what's called McCune-Albright syndrome. The final benign lesion that can affect the bone is called eosinophilic granuloma. This is a benign proliferation of cells called Langerhans cells. And it's also accompanied by other cells like eosinophils and other blood type of cells. Eosinophilic granuloma of bone is a part of a spectrum of disease called Langerhans cell histiocytosis that can affect multiple organs in the body. This tumor can be solitary or multiple. Generally, this is not really a tumor, but it's part of a disorder of the immune system, because these Langerhans cells are part of our immune system, most specifically the innate immune system. Most commonly, these tumors affect the skull. Some of these lesions may spontaneously resolve, but others can persist. Surgery is usually required for the weight-bearing bones because weight-bearing bones are liable to fracture. Intralesional corticosteroids and irradiation can be done for inaccessible lesions. If we cannot access the lesion by surgery, if it's too deep in the bone, we can access it with intralesional corticosteroids or irradiation. That's it for the first video. In the next video, we're going to discuss the malignant bone tumors. Thank you all for watching. Please, again, don't forget to subscribe to the channel and also like the video. And don't forget to subscribe to our Facebook page, Medical Podiatrist, for more questions and answers and interactive material. See you next time.